Thanks for being here, Raymond.
So great to be here.
Yeah, it's always very fun talking with you. And so people here are talking about biomanufacturing. A lot of people don't know what that means, though. Like, what is biomanufacturing and how new is it?
It's actually, it's been around for about 10,000 years, so we can't say it's new on the scene. Yeah, but you know, nobody really thinks of it that way, because whenever we look at all the ways we make wine and beer, and that's actually some of the oldest technology humans have. Well, this is because, you know, we hijacked yeast and made it ferment things. And yeah, a lot of food that we have is fermented. Now we're just getting really, really good at it, and not just, I mean, making good craft beer, because you can do that too. But we can engineer these organisms to either produce different things for us, biofuels, bioplastics, food additives, cosmetics, specialized chemicals, medicines. We can also go ahead and engineer them to be sensors, to sort of be watchdogs in the environment to let us know if something's going on.
Like out sensing in like the atmosphere?
Yeah. Well, in a couple of ways. So, you know, the whole idea of sort of having something out in the environment, maybe in water, maybe in air, maybe sitting on your countertop to let you know there's a high level of toxins, kind of the thought of a smoke alarm, a CO2 alarm, but for everything that you don't want in your house, that's one way it goes. And another way is, whenever we start thinking about sensors, really we get closer and closer to, and this is a little bit of a step, but nanoengineering, you know. So if we can go ahead and produce sophisticated sensors and warning systems, what we're really doing is making little computers in the environment. And the interesting thing about biological computers is not how much memory they have, how fast they are, it's where they compute. So at some point, maybe you've got a sensor on your food packaging that says, you know, not just this cheese is good or bad, but this cheese has 7 days left, you know? Or this is at its best taste.
Eat me now.
Yeah, exactly. A little Lewis Carroll, Alice in Wonderland.
That's cool. And so what are some like practical applications of biotech in manufacturing today?
Well, we're starting to see more and more people have been using it as a marketing way to be green. And that's fantastic. And, you know, everybody cares. We're more conscious about what we buy. So maybe you're flying on an airline that's got a certain amount of biofuels, it's a sustainable way. Or maybe, you know, you're buying a product where the packaging is made from some bioplastic. The Coca-Cola plant bottle is a great example. But now it's not even just a marketing thing, because sometimes there's a markup to get it to happen. It's a way that we're doing cheaper and cheaper feedstock materials. So almost any detergent that you use, that was probably biomanufactured. And more things like soaps, degreasers, and some of these things have biological activity. But where we're really getting is, if you want to process a recycling stream, you know, and something as simple as grinding up plastic so it doesn't go in the ocean, and then going ahead and cooking it down and reforming it into new plastic. That's a great way. Something as complex as if you've got a smartphone, and everybody does, and you turn that over, you know, maybe 2 years, maybe 6 months, it kind of depends. And then what happens to all those really complex components? Right now, you probably get rid of it if you don't throw it in the trash. That's irresponsible, right? Somebody recycles it, and they start pulling the components off in India or someplace, and they're breathing in toxic dust. It's a mess. And what you really want to do is not have that environmental problem, that health problem. You'd really even more, too, like to recover those materials and reuse them again. Some of that's really expensive, really tactical. So what if we grind up all those cell phones and put them in a little bit of goop where bioorganisms are going and pulling out the different materials so they can be reused? And that's an example.
And are there any companies that you have your eye on, or startups that you've come across that you think have some like intriguing or novel product?
Yeah, there's, man, there's so many different ones. The thing that I'm actually so impressed with is the startup ecosystem. So being able to see who's doing what, and there are so many little companies that are doing the work of what used to be big, and maybe some medium-sized companies. So a two-person startup can really compete. Indie Bio in San Francisco is such a great example of a place where they've got a funnel where they're just bringing in people working in materials, food, medicine, and kind of giving them a launch pad to start lab space and fantastic attention. People who go through Indie Bio, it's kind of the Y Combinator of biotech.
Yeah, it definitely seems like it's become that. Mm-hmm. Yeah, and I think it speaks to just the huge ecosystem in the Bay Area of biotech.
And so many more. We're starting to see some of the biohacker spaces. A lot of those are for education, but a lot of them are commercial now. Mm-hmm. And people will even zero in on one specific piece where they're like, well, we've got this IP. Who are other people who are working in the field?
Yeah.
So you have really little ones. There's some in San Diego that are working on exosomes, which is this vanishingly small, narrow field, but what a great way to concentrate all the talent that way.
What is an exosome?
An exosome, it's kind of funny. It's a little greasy bubble. But it's important because it floats around in your bloodstream, for instance, and it can deliver drugs. It can float around in the environment and protect the things that are inside of it. And so it's a way that people have been using to practice drug delivery, DNA delivery. Mm-hmm. We're seeing things like that. And then on the other end of that scale, Johnson & Johnson, they've got Janssen Labs.
Right.
That's sort of taking the biohacker concept and saying, well, what would that look like if a huge corporation executed that in 12 different centers around the world? I think they've got 2,000 companies now that have been in residence and have graduated from Janssen Labs.
Wow. And so, this makes me think there's this really interesting tension between the biohacker movement in biotech, which is kind of fringe, funky, into hacking and new solutions. Then you have manufacturing and the more corporate way of doing things. And they're kind of coming together in some scenarios. Like, how do you think that tension can play with each other in a positive way?
Yeah. And sometimes, the biohacker movement is a little proud sometimes of its, like, leather jacket,
like rebel,
sunglass, swagger. And sometimes it's a little bit about attention and blog posts. And that's okay. But it's really interesting to see big corporations, which tend to move along very slowly and kind of clunk in place. Well, those guys are the dinosaurs. And I mean that in a good way. They're towering and powerful, right? And then the biohackers are sort of the mammals scurrying around their feet, and they're going out and finding new things and bringing it back. And so every once in a while, a mammal gets stepped on, you know. But the little mammals are kind of evolving. They're getting good at exploring that space. Mm-hmm. And where the real power is when the two meet and meet constructively, like you said.
In a constructive way, yeah.
Yeah. That some of it is, you know, and this is a very Singularity University way of doing things. Mm-hmm. We have small startups, people who are new in the field, are very interdisciplinary, exploring new ways to do things. Then we have large corporations that have money or marketing or old expertise. Mm-hmm. And whenever they can get together and use the best of each other, they inform both sides. And where they meet in the middle is where new things happen.
That's the magic.
Yeah.
Yeah. And so just to kind of wrap things up, I guess, what are your hopes for how biotech could really impact manufacturing in our future? Do you have kind of a horizon in 10 years that you're hoping will come true?
Yeah, I think in 10 years, most products that are manufactured that are not just straight out bending metal, and most things that are bending metal maybe get a little replaced by something that looks like some sort of admixture of smart materials.
Right? Yeah.
And I think we're going to start to see significant inroads. We're going to be at the beginning of that S-curve where most things are biologically manufactured. Almost everything is biologically rendered to be recycled, to be tracked. We're going to see some really weird ways where biology is being used. I just saw there are two new companies I just found out about in the last couple of days that are using DNA to tag manufactured goods. DNA is the ultimate barcode. And it gets cheaper and cheaper to read it. Why not use it? And it becomes a way to authenticate and trace and do all kinds of things. So some of these weird ways where biology will sort of leap the boundaries. But really, in about 20 years, I would be wholly surprised if we didn't have very decentralized manufacturing of materials and ways to grow very complex substrates, what we would think of as machines and computers. You know, so a very science fictional future.
Yeah. Yeah, I think, can you comment at all on some of the new synthetic materials that are being built in biotech?
Yeah, yeah. The one of my favorite ones is what's going on with bolt threads right now, and that's just amazing. They've been working and working. There's sort of maybe a 7-year overnight success story, but they've been quietly working about how to make spider silk by reprogramming yeast. And so they've done it, and they've got not just the ability to make it in large quantities, but the ability to tune the properties of the materials.
Wow.
Yeah, so you can make a silk that would carry water or not, or would be stretchier or stronger, have a better shear strength, better twist strength, and so they can kind of navigate all the space of possible properties and make something to order. And that really looks interesting. You know, think about having a little bulletproof onesie for your kids or something.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Or a wetsuit for surfing where you never get cold.
Exactly. And very doable. I mean, that would be a great biological biomimicry kind of thing to do.
Wonderful. Raymond, talking with you is always so much fun. Thank you so much.
Me too. Thanks, Alison.